Hello, educators, and welcome to the Making HEADway Classroom series. I'm David Chak, co-founder of ARUS Academy in Malaysia. Before establishing the academy, I spent 7 years as a secondary school teacher teaching students geography and science. Today, I'm excited to share with you how I teach the concept of density, a topic from Malaysia Form 1 or Grade 7 science syllabus, which is introduced right at the start of their secondary school science learning experience. This video series is part of the HEAD Foundation's Making HEADway ecosystem, an open access suite of teacher professional development offerings for Southeast Asian educators. You can watch past webinars through the link in the description and find my contribution in the handbook Teaching STEM in Southeast Asia. Check out more free resources by clicking the link in the description. Science lessons can be some of the most exciting parts of a student's learning journey. Science helps answer big questions about the world around us, such as why is the sky blue? Why does the sun set on one side and rises on the other? And why ice floats in drinks? But let's face it, many teachers struggle to demonstrate theories through hands-on experiments due to a lack of equipment or resources in their classroom. Often, we rely too much on theory, which doesn't capture the wonders of science. It doesn't have to be that way. Some of the most engaging and exciting experiments can be done using everyday items, things you already own, or things you can easily get from a supermarket. Today, I will show you how to teach density to lower secondary school students in a way that sparks curiosity and it works even in a low resource setting. To conduct this experiment in your classroom, you will need liquids of different densities. Today, I'm using honey, milk, dish soap, water, oil, and rubbing alcohol. You can use as few as 2 or 3 liquids or as many as you like. Additionally, you also need food coloring and a clear container. For this, I'm using a recycled plastic bottle. Finally, bubble tea with tapioca pearls is also required. The objective of this lesson are for students to understand the concept of density through experimentation, relate experimental observation to density formulas and calculation, and use their knowledge of density to explain things they see in their daily life. For students to fully understand the lesson, they should come prepared with a good conceptual understanding of mass and volume, as we'll be using these elements in our density calculations. This lesson exemplifies phenomenon-based learning. By creating a density column with students, we aim to spark their interest and encourage them to ask crucial investigative questions about why this phenomena occurs in their daily lives. This learner-centered approach introduces scientific concepts in a way that makes science come alive in front of their students, prompting them to think about the science behind everyday's phenomena. Let's think about the drinks we see in daily lives. 3-layered tea, bubble tea, or iced tea. To spark our students' curiosity, you may ask them, what makes these drinks form these beautiful layers? Why ice and bubbles float, and why milk mixes in with the drink when we stir it? The answer lies in density. But what exactly is density? Density is how much stuff or mass is packed into a certain amount of space or volume. For example, imagine 2 plates, one smaller and one larger, both with equal amounts of rice. The smaller plate is said to be more dense because the rice is packed into a smaller space. In short, density equals to mass divided by volume. We see density in action everywhere, like in 3-layered tea or ice floating in drinks. Let's bring this concept to life with an experiment you can do in your classroom, using only household items. Now, moving on to the experiment itself. We are going to create what is called a density column to show the effects of differences in density. For this experiment, I'm using 5 liquids of different densities: honey, milk, dish soap, water, and oil. Here, I'm adding food coloring into the water to make it easier to distinguish from other liquids. You also need a clear container. I'm using a recycled plastic bottle, but feel free to use any other clear container. Begin by pouring honey into the clear container. Next, do the same for milk. Make sure when you're pouring the milk, it goes down the side of the bottles and onto the honey layer so that it doesn't break the surface tension of the liquid. Next, do the same thing for dish soap. Water. And finally, oil. And voila, you see something amazing happen here. The liquids begin forming clear, distinct layers in the plastic bottle. So, why does this happen? It's all because of density. The liquid at the bottom, honey, is the densest, while each layer above it is slightly less dense, with oil being the least dense of them all. Let's revisit what density is. Density refers to how much mass is packed in a given volume. Denser liquids like honey sinks to the bottom, while less dense liquid like oil floats on top. This means that the same volume of honey is heavier than the same volume of oil. Each of the layers we have used has a density number associated with it. Water, for example, has a density number of 1 gram per cubic centimeter. Using the formula density equals to mass divided by volume, this means that 1 cubic centimeter of water weighs 1 gram. Therefore, the density number of water is 1.0. Here are the density numbers for each of the liquid we have used, starting from the bottom. Honey at 1.42, milk at 1.05, dish soap at 1.03, water at 1.0, and oil at 0.92. Going back to our formula, this means that 1 cubic centimeter of honey weighs 1.42 grams, while 1 cubic centimeter of dish soap weighs 1.03 grams, and so on. As I pour in each of these liquids in decreasing density, they sit on top of each other to form the density column we now see. Now you can ask your students this question. What do you think will happen if I pour in the rubbing alcohol with a density of 0.79 grams per cubic centimeter? Where will the rubbing alcohol go? Give your students some time to think about the answer. Let's see what happens. The rubbing alcohol will go on top of the oil because its density of 0.79 grams per cubic centimeter is less than the density of oil at 0.92 grams per cubic centimeter. If I drop a steel screw of around 7.7 grams per cubic centimeter, it will drop to the bottom of the column. But what about a cherry tomato of around 0.95 grams per cubic centimeter? Yep, it will just be in the middle. Below the oil, but above the water. Isn't that cool? Now that we know what density can do, let's revisit the calculation for density and see if we can calculate the density number of everyday object. Let's use the tapioca pearl from this bubble tea as an example. Assume that the tapioca pearl has a weight of 1.5 gram and a volume of 1.3 cubic centimeter. To calculate the density of this pearl, we can use the formula density equals to mass divided by volume. In this case, the density of the tapioca pearl is 1.5 gram divided by 1.3 cubic centimeter, giving us a density number of 1.15 gram per cubic centimeter. What about this tapioca pearl? For the sake of this calculation, let's assume that there is air trapped inside the pearl during the cooking process. So even though the volume of the pearl is still roughly the same as the previous one at 1.3 cubic centimeter, its weight has now slightly reduced because a part of it is now inflated by the air trapped inside the pearl. So it now has a weight of 1.2 gram. What is its density? We can calculate the pearl's density by dividing 1.2 gram, the mass, by 1.3 cubic centimeter, the volume. This gives us a density number of around 0.92 gram per cubic centimeter. Now, ask your students this question. Between these two tapioca pearls A at 1.15 gram per cubic centimeter and pearl B at 0.92 gram per cubic centimeter, which one will float and which one will sink in the bubble tea that has a density of around 1.1 gram per cubic centimeter? That's right, pearl A will sink and pearl B will float. Want to take this activity further? Encourage your students to introduce new liquids into the column and predict where it will land. This promotes inquiry-based learning and builds curiosity. Density doesn't just show up in our drinks. Ask your students if they have seen pictures of floating iceberg or have heard about oil spills in the ocean. Why is it that ice and oil both float on water? That's because both oil and ice are less dense than seawater, so they float instead of sink. Or look at a glass of soft drink. See those bubbles rising to the surface? That's density in action. The gas in the bubbles is less dense than the liquid, so it floats. Not only that, hot air is less dense than cold air, which gives us hot air balloons, winds, or even global weather patterns. If I were to repeat the same experiment with hot and cold water, you will see that the hot water remains floating on top of cold water because it is less dense than the cold water. Density is everywhere in our lives, much like science. It's not something that is confined to a classroom or textbook. By using everyday items and connecting science to phenomena students see in their daily lives, we can show students what science is really about. It is alive and it's something that the students can exploit on their own. Let's recap what we have done in this lesson. We started by briefly explaining the concept of density, and then we moved into hands-on experiment to see density in action. And finally, we concluded by going deeper into the concept of density, doing some calculations, and making predictions based on what we have learned. Hypothesis, observation, and prediction are important scientific inquiry skills that we want to promote in our children. Through this lesson, not only can we teach our students about the concept of density, but we can also promote essential scientific thinking skills such as hypothesis testing and prediction while relating real-life phenomena to the scientific concepts. I still remember being 11 years old when my science teacher let us make a Newton disc to show how white light is made out of seven colors. When those seven colors blended into one, I was amazed. Moments like this planted my love for science and inspired me to keep asking questions about the world. Even now, science experiments excite me as much as they did back then. These moments remind me why it's so important to make science fun, exciting, and accessible for today's students. When I became a teacher, I strive to make science fun for my students. In fact, the activity I just demonstrated, I did it every year for my new class of students, and they couldn't stop talking about it for weeks afterwards. So teachers, let's make science unforgettable for our students. With a little creativity, some everyday items, and lots of passion, you can inspire the next generation of curious minds. Remember, the best science lessons aren't about fancy equipment or memorizing formulas. They are about sparkling wonder and amazement. Let's show our students that science is not only something to be learned, but something they can experience. We appreciate you being a part of the journey of exploration today. To discover more insights and creative teaching techniques, check out the links in the description. Until next time, thank you for watching.